The views, comments, and opinions of the following program do not necessarily reflect those of Morris Media Studios, MorrisMediaLive.com, or its affiliates. Listener discretion is advised.
New York is in the grips of a crime wave.
It was like the heyday of crack.
It was violent, man.
Homicides, robberies, rapes. It was a war zone.
East New York, Brooklyn, 75 precinct, the deadliest precinct in the country. Who did I burn to get put here? It would scare Clint Eastwood.
When I first went to the precinct, I hear about this guy, Mike Dowd.
Mikey's just crazy.
Michael Dowd was a crook who ended up wearing a cop's uniform.
He was a criminal.
Once in a generation, corrupt cop.
I consider myself both a cop and a gangster.
Forget about Beverly Hills and all that other stuff. The ghetto is one of the richest neighborhoods there is.
Maybe there's some way we can make money from this.
La Compañía, it's a very serious Dominican gang.
$24,000 in our hands to talk.
Mike was a brain. Say no problem.
In his business, if you mess up, you got killed.
I'm a New York City cop. I'm taking a risk of going to jail for a long period of time, and you're gonna short me a dime?
His word against mine. And I'm a cop. I'd break your neck if your neck needs a breaking.
I had three machines counting money, and it's still not enough time.
Everybody on the floor now.
There's no becoming a cop again.
You're gonna have me killed.
We knew we were up against a really tough crew.
A month ago, I was a regular cop, and now I'm a criminal.
That's what they taught us in the police academy.
Got a guy in the front, guy in the back, got an entry team.
You felt like you were God.
The normal person that's doing wrong is going to have a fear of being caught.
I never had a fear about getting busted.
Michael Dowd did not have any fear.
Because the cops around me would never give me up.
All right, welcome to this week's edition of the Ride Along Radio Show. I'm your host, George Holt. And we showed you that trailer there for the 7-5 documentary, because it does a much better job than I ever could of introducing my new co-host. And here he is, in the flesh, the Mike Dowd from the 7-5 documentary. And as you saw, Mike was a former New York City police officer. And I think he's got a unique perspective from a couple different angles. And he's a great conversationalist. If you've ever seen the 7-5, you know why I felt compelled to reach out to this man and get him here. And it's been years. Took some years to get you here. But to get him here and to add his voice to the conversation. So welcome, Mike Dowd, to the Ride Along Radio Show.
Yeah, I'm very happy to join the ride. And I'm hoping that this ride takes off and we begin to be able to discuss some of the things that I've experienced along with yourself.
Sure.
And give a perspective that many people might wonder what the perspective is, and maybe they even have their own idea about it, but I've lived both sides of the fence, so this should be an interesting ride. I hope get in the car with us and let's see how
and
let's see how it goes.
And as we drive around our virtual city here and we chat, you can call in, add your voice to the conversation at 323-815-4204. And you know, looking at that and seeing some of the excerpts, and I've seen the documentary itself a few times, and I know that there's sound bites that maybe make things sound a little different. But when you look at that documentary, do you feel it was a fair representation of the story from your perspective, or did they kind of take some liberties?
So, and by now, that's been, that was filmed in 2012.
It was, okay,
it
was it?
It was put together, and then by the time it was released, it was 2015, end of 14, beginning of 15.
So roughly five, yeah.
Yeah, so I look back at it, and I say, you know, there were a couple of areas where I would say they just took some license in it. And as we go along, we can maybe hit that at some point. But,
sure.
But the reality is it's fairly accurate overall. Fairly accurate. Some people's perspectives are different than mine. And
right.
Some people's memories are different than mine.
Of course.
But one of the things I like to share with people, if I spent 12 and a half years in prison, so my memory is pretty clear. you know?
Right.
Well, people were out there living a life, right? Sure. And they didn't go to prison. So their view is their view.
Right. They don't have the, right. They didn't pay the price.
Yeah, well, not only did they not pay the price, I think just to be direct is when people are living a life, they're going home, they're raising kids, they're going to work, they're dealing with life. They don't have the time to reflect on what happened.
Yeah.
So some of the perspectives are slightly different.
Sure.
You know? However, you know, mine are right.
Okay. Right. Right. Of course. Of course. Being a cop in New York City at that time, and you know, I started my career in the late 80s in L.A. and the housing projects, height of the gang war. But some of the stuff I saw depicted in the documentaries, like, makes me go, wow, that was pretty rough there, too. Like, that's a whole different level of rough out there. You know, I mean, was it really that rough as, like, it's being depicted in the documentary?
I would say the words describe it clearly, and the visual is pretty much some areas of, that we worked through. Yeah. And although many of those pictures were not specifically the 75 precinct, it was taken from... like if I described the precinct, those are the that would be the description of locations throughout the precinct.
Okay.
That we had blocks that were leveled, you know, like wow. like if people know anything about Brooklyn, like Hinsdale and Riverdale, you know, like there was probably three block area with one building in it, and that happened to be, you know, a place where there was a lot of money.
Oh wow!
One building, five stories high. No one lived there.
But this just developed.
But a lot of money came out of that.
They're just knocking stuff down around it, or
yeah,
just...
yeah. So at one point they were probably five story brownstones, or you know,
okay, sure.
And then throughout the years we burnt out, and you know, so rather they, how do you, you know, you don't put a project up if that be the case, or a housing
right.
establishment up around one or two buildings that are still
right,
standing.
You can't. Yeah.
So yeah, so it would. It would continually, ongoingly disintegrate.
Oh, sure.
And no,
just over time.
And
nobody's putting any money into it.
No one put any money into it. So
right.
It laid like that. And it was hazardous, to say the least, right? I mean,
sure.
I mean, being in a housing project, most of them are occupied, I would assume.
Oh, yeah. Most, we had some abandoned units, but for the most part,
yeah.
We never have a whole block
yeah,
of buildings.
Yeah, but we had blocks that
yeah,
were
never.
Empty. And then it, sometimes like the city would come in, dozed down 10.
Right.
You know, and now you had nothing but rubble, which you saw
sure,
depicted
and
in
stuff,
there.
Sure.
And then because they dozed them down or something because they were crack houses and
right.
stuff like that. And dangerous.
Sure.
Really, really dangerous. Bodies showed up. I mean, they knocked buildings down.
You know, and bodies inside?
Bodies be inside. You know?
That's like The Wire. I mean, when I watched The Wire on HBO's The Wire, it was set in Baltimore.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been in that neighborhood in Baltimore mm-hmm. before. But I just still thinking, man, is it really, really like that, you know?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, when you have multiple story tenement housing, I would imagine, you know, your problems would go up tenfold too.
Right, which is why they, many years later, they called them the Nehemiah houses. Like they were three story.
Okay.
So they didn't want that to happen.
Right. They didn't want
so
all that vertical problem.
You compact it into a smaller area. If there was going to be problems, at least if it was spread out, it wouldn't be so severe.
Right. Because you'd hear about all the crap going on in the stairwells, right?
Oh, yeah.
So being
and
a housing
you, and
cop.
That's your game there.
Right.
Yeah.
So being a housing cop, dealing with guys from Chicago Housing Authority and Pittsburgh Housing Authority and New York Housing Authority and just going to conferences and hearing the stories. About the vertical enforcement they were having to do in those stairwells
oh, yeah.
and all the crap that was going on in their stairwells.
Yeah.
That's bananas to me, man. And, yeah. and our tallest housing projects are two stories. You know what I mean? It's laid out a little
some
different
wisdom,
than it
some
is
wisdom
back there.
It was learned, right?
Right. I
mean, wisdom came from.
Well, and the thing is, some of it started off as like military housing.
Okay.
So it wasn't really set up for low income anyway, at
initially.
Least initially.
Right.
It just kind of became that.
Right.
So maybe that was also. The thing
a blessing in
too.
A way. Right?
It really was, yeah, because we didn't have
can you
all
imagine
those
15
issues.
Stories of the same thing?
Oh my God,
yeah. It just didn't end.
I just can't imagine that. I've been by the old Robert Taylor homes in Chicago before they tore them down right there on Lakeshore Drive.
Uh-huh.
And that real estate's like super expensive, Lakeshore Drive.
Right, sure.
And I see why they're tearing the projects down.
Right.
When I drive by it, I'm
right.
like, there's no way they're going to let that high dollar real estate sit there
right.
and just, you know, just nothing.
Right. Okay.
So they tore it down and. When I was in Chicago a couple of years ago doing a movie out there, I drive by and it's a total different thing over there, man.
Right, yeah, it's amazing. It's amazing as you talk about that because it brings back to some thoughts in my head because I in East New York we, you know, it's ghetto whatever, but it's on the water. It's on
right,
the,
isn't that
it's,
something?
It's on the Jamaica Bay.
It's prime
know?
Real estate.
Yeah, I mean, my goodness, and then like
yeah, location,
right?
Yeah.
So yeah, it's interesting as you bring that up.
Yeah, absolutely, man. So, you know, one of the things we do on the show here is we will have a current event or a newsworthy event, and we'll kind of break it down from a law enforcement perspective, and we'll look at it and say, okay, so this is, as police officers, this is our take on this, or this is my take, that's your take, or whatever.
Right.
And, you know, and our takes aren't always going to be the same. If you guys are friends with either or both of us on Facebook, you'll know that we don't agree on a lot, a whole lot, which is why you were the perfect guy to step into this role, because you got to have that balance there, right? To keep it interesting.
Right.
And one of our first conversations is we talked about, you know, good cop, bad cop, right? Was kind of the concept, right? And I say again that, you know, when you finish watching this show, you may be wondering who's who. Because you may look at me and say, that dude's all screwed up with some of his thoughts and his ideology. And they may look at you and say the same thing. It's all perspective, right? So,
but I think in the end of the day, they'll understand that we respect each other. That's
right. Absolutely.
That's key.
And that's the key.
You know, and if this gets heated or the discussion is a little bit off-centered, my credo is we can agree to disagree.
Absolutely.
And maintain civility. For the most part.
Yeah.
And you're bigger than me anyway. So
by much. Not by much, but a little bit. Yeah. This is bigger than he looks in the documentary. Let's just put it like that.
Well, I haven't the gym, you know.
Right. There you go.
They cut out the gym on me. So.
Yeah, they did. Almost everywhere, right?
Yeah.
So there was a protest going on nationwide right now. And protests everywhere from Portland to Beverly Hills to New York to Denver to Chicago, et cetera. Right. And there was a protest, a protester who was shot, because what started to happen is people protest, counter-protesters show up.
Right.
So if BLM shows up, you may have the Proud Boys show up. Or if the Proud Boys are there first, then you may have Antifa show up or any of the alt-right dudes or whoever. You would now have counter-protesters. It only mattered time before that went stupid, right? And we've seen it happen. We saw it happen in Kenosha, Wisconsin with Kyle Rittenhouse.
Right.
And we recently had this happen in Denver. So we're going to play the video of the shooting incident at the protest in Denver. And then we'll come back and talk about self-defense and how different people... This incident's almost a litmus test for your political views, because different people are looking at it different ways.
Right.
Even though it's the exact same incident, we all see the same thing.
Right.
The political violence in our streets as opposing rallies turned deadly in Denver over the weekend. This dramatic image captures the moment right before the gunshot. Police say that the man on the left used pepper spray on the man on the right, who then appears to draw a firearm and then fatally shoots the man spraying him. The suspect, identified as a security guard hired to protect a local news crew. ABC's Clayton Sandell has more.
Tonight, new questions about a security guard hired by a local TV station now under investigation for first-degree murder. After a deadly shooting following protests that had been mostly peaceful. It happened as groups from the far right and far left had gathered for competing rallies Saturday in downtown Denver. Lee Keltner, in the camouflage hat, is seen arguing with a man before moving out of frame. Denver Post photojournalist Helen Richardson capturing the moment Keltner and another man, 30-year-old Matthew Doloff, get physical. It escalates immediately. Keltner appears to slap Doloff, who draws a gun. Keltner unleashing a cloud of pepper spray. Then that single shot. Keltner is fatally wounded.
I don't know why he went from one argument to another. This all happened in 2 seconds. I didn't go to this event ever in my life expecting this to happen. It's just sad that someone lost their life over this.
Police rush in seconds later, taking Doloff into custody. TV station KUSA says Doloff was working for them, but the city of Denver says he was not properly registered as a security guard. KUSA says Doloff was hired through the Pinkerton agency, but Pinkerton says Doloff was not an employee and worked for an outside vendor. The company says it's fully cooperating with the investigation, and we take loss of life in any situation very seriously.
And Lindsay, Doloff is being held on investigation of first-degree murder. He has not entered a plea, but officials also tell us that if he was operating as a security guard without a license, he could face fines and even jail time. And one more thing, there's been a lot of online speculation that Doloff was a member of Antifa or some other radical left-wing organization. Denver police have now twice shot that down, saying it is not true. Lindsay?
Clayton, thank you.
Hi, everyone. George Stephan.
So that incident there, depending on if you're more of a Antifa type or you're more of a Proud Boy type or whatever, I'm seeing people defending both sides of it, right?
Right.
And I'll just say this. I've heard police officers say, and I've seen them write it on their social media, that if anyone were to take their pepper spray and try to use it on them, taser, it's a little bit different, et cetera, anything that could incapacitate them and compromise their ability to protect themselves, that that would justify deadly force. I've heard people say that. Okay, I'm not saying that I agree with that. But then I know that some of these same people will look at this incident and go, oh, that wasn't right. He shouldn't have shot that guy. And people are mixing politics into it as opposed to just saying, this is what happened. You heard what they said about the online speculation that they're, the guy's an Antifa hardcore left-wing dude or whatever.
Right.
That was put out there, and people are saying, oh, this is a social media page. I saw all that. And it turns out not to be true. So I don't know why we got to politicize that kind of thing.
What turns out to not be true?
A lot of stuff they were putting out there that, oh, this is his social media, and he's a member of Antifa. He is this, that, or other. It was all fabricated. It was people coming up with stuff to dirty this dude up. Now, I'm not saying that he doesn't have...
I did look at some of his
That's what I'm going to say. I'm not saying that it was all completely fabricated, but there was a lot of things that extras were put on it.
Let's be clear.
Extras were put on it, and this is why Denver PD is saying...
We would say he's definitely left.
That's not it. Yeah, sure.
Okay.
That much appears to be clear.
Okay.
But like card carrying member of Antifa, et cetera, et cetera.
I'm not going to go there.
People are, but why even do that? Instead, let's just talk about what happened here. We saw the same thing with Kyle Rittenhouse in Kenosha.
Right.
Why was the incident justified? Never mind how the dude's going to vote next month. Ain't neither one of them voting for nothing, by the way. I think they're both going to be locked up.
Isn't that what this is about?
Well, but see, see how that gets into everything?
Right.
And that guy would tell you that he wasn't there to protest. He was there to do his job, protect the news crew.
Okay.
And then this happened, right? So it's not like he showed up as a protester at all.
So how I see it is he injected himself into a situation. He wasn't even there to protect these people that he was dealing with. The reporter wasn't there. The first people he stepped between was a guy wearing a shirt that said, Black Guns Matter?
I saw something about that. They blacked it out, so I couldn't see exactly what he had on.
The
first guy that was against the fence arguing.
They said he separated two people.
Mm-hmm.
One was the, let's call him the right wing guy that with the spray.
Right.
And another guy with Black Guns Matter.
Okay.
So he separated them.
Right.
They were arguing.
Right. And I think somebody reached out to touch him, but it wasn't the guy who ended up getting shot. And he's like, hey, you want to put your hands on me? Don't touch me.
Right. So he sort of interjected himself in.
But see, that's what I have to wonder. If you're there in security, and this is what I do for a living now, if you're there to be security for this news crew, whether or not it's that particular journalist, it could just be the cameraman.
Right.
Because you're protecting the asset and the employee.
All right.
Don't get involved in that.
Right.
Stay over here and do what you're supposed to be doing.
Yeah, but it's like an off-duty cop. You know, call 911.
Be a good witness. Don't get involved in that. Stay focused.
I mean, if life is at stake,
that's a little different.
You know, someone's having an argument. They're fighting. They're beating. They're punching each other a little bit. You know, no one's getting assaulted where they can't come.
But you don't interject yourself and become the story.
Right.
So, but here's the other question. Why did the gentleman who got shot decide to go over and get into that situation there? You know, and you see that there's some punches being thrown or some slaps at least being thrown.
It was a little physical.
Then a gun comes out.
I didn't see.
Pepper spray comes out. Which comes out first? I don't know which one came out first.
The pepper spray came out first.
Okay.
Yeah,
I
saw.
Was the gun a response to the pepper spray coming out?
I would have a feeling that the guy was intimidated and that gun was coming out.
Regardless.
Right. In other words, maybe just to.
Back
the guy off.
Yeah. You don't do that though, man. You don't pull your gun unless.
But
we know that.
Right. But so there you go.
We know that. He's a security guard.
And to protect himself, he thought, I mean, the guy was a bit bigger than him.
Yeah, you know, sure.
A little old, but not an old man, by the way.
No, he wasn't an old man.
Yeah, but
that dude would still hurt you.
You know, he was like one of our guests, a little gray or premature. A little premature gray. Right.
But he was a big guy.
Yeah.
And, you know, kind of one of these guys that comes off kind of as a tough guy.
Right.
But, you know, again, and the reason I asked is which came first, because it's the chicken or the egg, right?
Right.
So if you pull your pepper spray and now I'm pulling my gun because I don't want you to pepper spray
it wasn't
me,
very far after it, right? So which one is it?
Or do you pull your gun and I go, well, all I got is this pepper spray, but I ain't going to let you shoot me. So let me put this cloud up and get out of the way. I don't really know.
Right.
And from the video, what we just saw, it's hard to tell. Now, there's other footage out there, but it's kind of hard to tell which one came first because here's the thing. You have a right to self-defense until you don't.
Right.
Right? It only goes so far.
Yeah.
And it's right. It's got to be reasonable.
Yeah.
Whatever your response is.
I mean, and from my political view on it is that that guy with the gun was itching for something, got himself involved. I don't believe he went there to shoot anybody, but I think he thought he was out of his league with this guy.
Right.
And his response was like, and you know, cops do that too.
Yeah.
Cops do overreact.
I got a gun,
yeah.
So
yeah, yeah.
I can do this.
I'm going to try to prevent you. But we got a call. You want to cut to the call? Yeah.
Okay, cool. Hey, caller, what's your name and where are you calling from?
My name's Frank. I'm calling from Florida.
Frank from Florida.
Hey,
what
Frank.
Do you got for us, Frank? How you doing?
Doing good. Just want to call in and, speak a little bit about Mike and let everybody know. I know Mike personally.
Oh, thanks, Frank. Oh, that's you. Hey, Frank. Thanks for calling in.
Hey, he's just a great guy that's really out there doing some good things and helping a lot of people and taking his experiences and helping out actual cops that are active now and talking them through some hard times. It's tough out there right now to be wearing a badge. And Mike's definitely got a lot of experience, and he's out there helping a lot of people through some tough times. And he gives a lot of himself to the community. People don't see it. They characterize him from the documentary, and
right.
And they see Mike one way, but they don't realize the actual good in his, the goodness in his heart and the lessons that he's learned. And he's really out there helping people and doing a lot of good stuff out there for the, whether it's individuals or speaking to groups, to large groups of investigators, teaching agencies about corruption, just doing a lot of help out. He's giving a lot of help out there, and he's a really good guy.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, Frank, and I appreciate the call, man. Thanks for calling in.
Thanks, Frank.
No problem.
Yeah, and I do want to talk to you about what you're doing nowadays too. After we get finished with this segment,
yeah,
so
that was nice.
Yeah, that was cool.
Put a tear in my eye.
From Florida, all the way from Florida.
Yeah.
So again, you know, I've seen people do it, and we teach concealed weapons classes to civilians. And I always tell people, don't let that gun get you in trouble. Don't think that you can go into a biker bar, talk a yard of shit to everybody in there, mm-hmm. and if they get stupid, you can pull that pistol and get yourself out of it.
That's not gonna work.
Don't do that.
Yeah.
Don't get yourself, act like you don't have a gun. I always tell people that too. Be polite, be low key, act like you don't have a gun. Don't be interjecting yourself and interposing yourself in situations just because you feel like you can shoot your way out.
Yeah, I'll give you a quick synopsis.
Sure.
I 10 years, Brooklyn cop, in and out of fights, bar fights,
sure.
scene situations, and I learned one thing. If you pull that gun out, it's time to shoot because pulling that gun out will inflame people.
Right, everybody ain't scared of that
gun.
Yeah,
they're not scared.
Yeah.
Like, you think that pull a gun, people want you to, go ahead, shoot. I mean, I've heard that. Go ahead, shoot.
Oh, matame. Out here we say that, right? How many times you heard that? Yeah. Matame. Matame, yeah, marico.
Shoot me,
matame,
shoot me.
Right?
Pull a knife out, the motherfucker ain't going to say stab me. I'll tell you right now. Oh, you got a knife. Fuck that. But a gun?
A gun,
go ahead,
right.
Pull it, shoot me. What?
Well, they also know we have rules of engagement, and you can pull a gun on somebody. Like, the first time I ever pulled a gun on somebody in real life, guy stolen a car, bends the corner, gets out. He's bopping down the street like he got nothing, like he didn't do nothing. But I saw you.
Yeah, right.
Right. So I'm with my training officer. This is my second day in the field.
Right. Yeah.
So I bail out, got my department issue Smith & Wesson revolver.
And your radio.
Right. And I'm good to go. And I start barking commands. I draw down this dude. I point the gun at him, and he did like this, and he laid down. And I took him to jail. And I thought, well,
serious?
That was easy. Well, it set me up. For false expectations, because the next time I pulled the gun on somebody who was a parolee,
and he had
guns pointed at him before because he's a real underworld cat.
Yeah, right.
And he knows I'm not going to shoot him.
You're not allowed.
I'm not allowed just to shoot this dude. Now, maybe if I was another gangbanger, he'd have a different response.
Right.
But I'm standing there in full uniform. Yeah. He knows I'm not going to just
Nothing
shoot
you can
him.
Do.
Right.
Yeah.
If I don't give him a reason.
Yeah.
Right. And he wasn't scared.
Curse you out.
He can talk. He can punk. Keep. He's keep. He's running his mouth.
Shoot me.
And I'm like, don't you see? I got this gun pointed at you. You don't see this gun.
You don't think I don't use this?
You don't see this badge? He saw all of it. Didn't give a shit.
Yeah, nah.
So, that gun don't work on everybody unless you pull the trigger. Now, as we saw, if you pull the trigger, it works on everybody.
Yeah, that's work.
But the threat, the point in the gun doesn't do a whole lot for a lot of people.
It doesn't work out. Yeah. And the funny thing is, and when I was a cop in Brooklyn, excuse my French here. I pull my gun 8 to 10 times a day.
Oh, yeah.
A day.
Sure, all the time in the projects. A day. Not so much at the airport, but in the housing project.
And you know what? I was ready to use it 8 to 10 times a day. I never pulled it one time just for fluff.
Right.
Never.
Sure.
That's how it was.
Yeah.
You asked the question.
I get it.
We spoke earlier. 8 to 10 times a day. And that's on my
damn,
own
that's
job.
A lot, though,
that's
man.
Every.
Shit, that's a lot.
My gun just came out like this.
Right.
It just came right out. Because that's how it was.
Sure.
Back in the...
We got to clear a building, clear a car, whatever. Sure.
Clear nothing.
Stop somebody.
Clear
whatever.
Nothing. Like the job called, you know, man with a gun.
Sure. That's a radio
call. Man with
call.
A gun on the corner, blah, blah, description, white ponies, well, you know, Kango hat, backwards, whatever he got, you know.
Right.
And the gun's out. Boom.
Sure.
Out of the car, gun pointed right at the motherfucker like this.
Sure.
What's
sure.
That? And, you know, this was the regular. What's up, officer?
Right. Right.
No one there panicked. No one ran. Don't run because they're getting beat. I mean,
well, that's a different
it's
story.
It's not going to work out.
Back in the day, if you got at the end of that pursuit, if you got caught,
the worst thing you could do was run.
Right. Unless you got away.
Right.
Because when you got caught, then there was
consequences. Yeah, that's the worst thing was to get caught.
Yeah, absolutely.
Don't make me run.
Right. Don't make me chase you.
I tell you, I ran one time.
Yeah.
You know where I ended up?
Where?
Flat on my face. In front of a school bus.
Oh, my God.
A school bus.
Those
with
kids
a bunch of
probably
kids
still
laughing.
They're still laughing.
They'll probably call in tonight. I was young. Sure. I was in great shape, but my legs locked up. And I went, boop. Yeah. I learned right then, don't do that again.
Right. Well, let me ask you this. So how old were you when you came on the job?
I was 21 and 2 weeks. Yeah.
Fresh face, brand new.
Yeah.
So how much do you think...
I didn't shave. I had 3 whiskers.
So you didn't even need to shave. You could just pluck them.
Yeah, I can.
I started really young, too. I started at 23. I started a week after my 23rd birthday. Mm-hmm. I started the academy. Mm-hmm. And looking back on it now, having had a 25-year career, having spent most of that as a supervisor in 2 different agencies, a bunch of different capacities.
Studied?
Well, yeah.
Studied?
I studied and paid attention. But I will say that I don't think... And there's some 20-year-old whose birthday's tomorrow who's going to apply. He's going to get pissed. I'm getting ready to say this.
Yeah. Well,
but I don't think that we
York.
Should hire police officers.
York.
Well, I want you to talk about this. So I wouldn't hire a police officer. I was the chief of police. I wouldn't hire anybody under the age of 25. Probably 30. Just because of the amount of life experience you need to bring the proper perspective to this job, the level of maturity that you know that it takes to do this job. Now, of course, we have the psych and we have the selection process and all that, but I don't give a shit because I've been a 24-year-old in a police car with another 24-year-old. I'm not saying we were
it's
going
like a
out
frat
there.
House.
We weren't committing crimes.
No,
but it was some poor judgment shit that went on.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's why I say that I think you should be at least 25. The only thing I would make an exception is I would look at that person's background. Let's say a guy had been in the military, got out of the military, got married, he's got kids.
Right.
That 25-year-old, he's got responsibilities. That 25-year-old
right.
is different than a 25-year-old who just got out of college and has been hanging out with his buddies.
Pressing buttons on the computer.
Right. Yeah. Hanging out with his buddies for 2 years and decides, I want to be a cop now.
Yeah.
That's
a
little different.
I need a job. I'm going to be a police officer.
So when you say you changed that, what do you mean?
Well, so as a result of my escapades, or whatever you want to call it, that made me infamous, whatever the criminal analytics that I was involved in, I spoke before a commission called the Mullen Commission. And prior to my speaking in front of them, there was a whole series of couple weeks of interviewing and policy suggestions from me, like for real.
What do you think? Yeah.
Yeah. What do you think? So one of the subject matter questions was about my age and what did I think was a determinant effect on me as a young police officer. What do I think was the difference? And I said one of the things was at 20 years old and 21 years old, I'm telling a man 45, 46 years old with 3 kids who just came home from sheetrocking a couple of buildings in Manhattan or stonemason, you know, who's had a couple cold ones on a Friday night after he got paid, and he's yelling and screaming at his wife, and he's been paying his bills every week, and they're pissed off at each other. That and now I'm 21 years old telling this this guy, oh, you got to leave, you know.
His house.
You got to leave. This isn't the way you should be treating somebody. You know, your wife's scared. The kids are crying. You know. Now I'm 21, and he's looking at me saying, listen, motherfucker, I just worked all week. Yeah.
Right.
I got a kid in college, and you're telling me how I got to behave in my own house?
Right. Absolutely.
Maybe she should go. Yeah. I mean, you know.
Right. But see, and that's part of the many hats that a police officer has to wear and all the responsibilities that we get saddled with is that kind of thing. Now you're in people's life.
Right.
In their business, in their house.
Right.
He don't want you there.
Well, first of all, you got to realize, like this whole bring a social worker with you thing, whatever.
Right.
The fact is, the police are called there because there's a potential of violence.
Of violence, sure, right? Absolutely.
So it's not like, you know, send a social worker in and calm the situation down, you know, because that's just, I know that's one of the themes that's going on.
That's one of the things with defunding the police,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. So, but to go back to the original predicate that I think you were asking for is, I suggested that I should be older.
Yeah.
So what they ended up doing in New York City is they added 2 years to the minimum age to start.
From 20 to 22?
20 to 22. So what? It gives you a little...
It does give you a little bit.
Yeah, it gives you a little, you know, fluff, you know, where you can maybe either you finished college and you're ready for the work environment, or you graduated at 18 from high school.
Right.
Because basically the police department is taking graduates or GED people, so people who have accomplished something. So if you graduated at 18 and then now you're 22, that means 4 years in the street.
Yeah,
some kind of something. Right.
Right, what did you do?
You have to show something. Like, what did you do? Sure. I'm not your mother's basement. That's not going to
cut it.
That's not the candidate.
Well, right? Okay. So I knew a young lady many years ago who was a 29, about to be 30-year-old virgin. And she wanted to be a Los Angeles police officer.
Did you marry her?
I did not. Okay. No plans with that one. Okay. So
we couldn't get anywhere.
At that age, I was taking that as a challenge.
I'm not a misogynist, whatever. But I'm just saying. You know,
she was actually my first wife's friend.
Oh, there you go.
So and she was trying to come on the job, and I was thinking, because I was already on the job for a couple of years at that point, and I'm thinking, if you don't have the life experience, and I'm not saying you got to go out there and gap your legs for everybody, but if you're still a virgin and you haven't been in a live-in domestic kind of a situation, clearly you haven't.
Right.
Right?
No.
You all are taking it real slow if you have.
Or live in a nunnery, whatever.
Yeah. Right, right. So for you to come into a situation and not understanding the male-female dynamic to that extent, or the male-male or female-female, the extent that goes along with an intimate, years-long relationship, and you don't know those dynamics, you're not going to be as effective in that situation. You're not going to be as compassionate in that situation as someone with that life experience would be. She didn't make it for other reasons unrelated to that. Okay. She got hired. She passed the psych, passed the background, got hired.
But this was your wife.
And had some issues
in the
academy.
Your ex-wife's friend.
My first wife's friend, yeah.
Right.
So she
and you married this woman, the other one?
I was married to her friend. Okay. Yeah. Not the unsuccessful police candidate. But she,
you get my question?
Yes, like, I did.
Your first wife,
different person. Yeah. So
no, you're not getting it.
She tell me later.
Your wife's best friend is a virgin. What are you doing?
Oh, I see. Oh, that's scandalous.
How the hell could she?
Wow.
It just set me off. Like, you know.
Yeah.
Your ex-wife.
My ex, okay. First wife.
God
yeah.
bless her.
So yeah, God bless her. So, this lady didn't make it as a police officer. And she didn't make it as a police officer for reasons unrelated to that.
Right.
But I looked at that as God stepping in and saving her or saving someone from a situation that she would have been ill-prepared to step into.
Okay.
Okay? Yeah. And it was just like one of those situations where somebody still lived at home with her parents and, you know, just a real...
Okay, yeah, I mean, I can see the perspective, but I would look at that as if, like, someone was...
Jan Brady. She was a black Jan Brady.
I would look at that like a psychologist who never did anything but
read. Right, and by now you're going to try to counsel somebody.
But never read a book, you know?
Right, or yeah. You're a marriage counselor.
Right, and you've never been married. You've
never been married.
Or divorced, or never in a relationship.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's kind of the same thing in right. that I think that people should have some seasoning on them before you give them the heavy badge and the ominous responsibility that comes with carrying a gun in policing society.
Right.
Right. There's just so much that goes with it. You talk about moving from 20 to 22. Let me tell you what else this does also. There are some people who are shitheads, okay? And you haven't figured out that they're a shithead yet at 21.
Right.
Or they ain't got caught being a shithead yet at 21.
Right.
Right. So that guy, maybe on paper, he's a great candidate. And he slides through.
Right.
Because he doesn't get caught.
Right.
Doing shithead stuff that he does.
Right.
Give that dude 5 years.
Right.
His luck's going to get run out. It's going to run out.
Right.
He's going to get caught doing something that's disqualifying that he was doing all along.
Right.
But you give him 5 more years to get caught doing.
So one of the things that people may not be considering is that the ages on police departments have changed, right? Because now
the upper age has changed.
Yeah. So back then you had to be 29.
Or younger.
Or younger.
Yeah.
So your pool was narrower.
That's true.
You know?
That's
so
true.
That's something that,
yeah,
without mentioning it, you're not aware of, because today you can come on as late as, I don't know.
Oh, I've seen guys come out of academy at 50.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? There's no real age limit anymore.
That's what I'm saying.
CHP, I think, still, the California Highway Patrol, I think, has a 38-year
age limit. I think NYPD is in the 38 or 39 range, I think. They may have changed it, but that's what I recall. So people can come on after having a career.
I knew guys who came out of the military.
Yeah,
I knew guys who did 20 years in the military and became cops.
Yeah, well, first of all, that time counts too. Right,
towards you can tie it together for you. You can buy some of that time, right, for your retirement.
Yeah, you can't buy 20 of it, but you can buy some of it. Yeah. I think 5 or 6, whatever.
But this gave him a chance by that age not being 35 anymore or being 29.
Right.
It gave a guy a chance to go in the military at even 21 after college, do his 20 years, come out at 41, 42, and have a viable career as a police
officer.
Right.
So the shooting that we were talking about when we got off into this 22-year age thing is the In Denver. So, what did you think on that scene? I probably gave you what my perspective was.
My perspective on it is this: I understand the person being threatened. I understand a person being intimidated. But like I said, you don't whip a gun out. You don't introduce a gun into a situation that you don't need to do that.
Right.
In that situation, to me, that dude could have gotten out of that. Or how about this? If the dude's going knuckles up, if he's knuckling up with you, knuckle up with
knuckle
him. Go
up
back from the shoulders.
Yeah.
If we're going from the shoulders, we're going from the shoulders.
Or turn away.
Or go.
Yeah.
Okay, but what happened was we had a situation where, okay, I'm getting my ass beat. Either one, and I don't know who pulled first.
Well, I think
he
slapped the guy in the head.
You can see the slapping being done.
Knocked his hat off.
Yeah, you can see the slapping being done. So now he's pissed off.
But the thing is this, and from my perspective, and I welcome any other perspective, it was more like a get the fuck out of here type of thing.
But that's dismissive as hell. And you can't slap a grown man and expect him not to be in his feelings about it. I'm not saying you can kill for it.
You can be dismissive or not, but the fact is, if I knock your hat off, you're punking me out or something.
You punked him out
for
everybody.
So, shoot me?
Cameras are rolling.
You're getting ready to shoot me for this? Right. Come on. There's no justification. Well,
but his justification is not going to be I shot him because he slapped my hat off. He slapped my hat off.
Right.
And again, I don't know when the gun came out.
Right.
But he didn't drop the hammer till the pepper spray
got deployed. We don't disagree on that fact. I just think that the whole thing could have been de-escalated.
On both of their parts.
When the guy slaps his hat, he should just pick up his hat and walk away and say, you know what? I don't belong in this argument anyway. I'm supposed to be protecting a reporter over here.
He couldn't do it. He couldn't do it, man. He couldn't take that. But, you know,
no one needed to die there, right?
Nobody needed to die. Nobody needed to pull a gun or pepper spray anybody.
Which is much like some of the situations where we've had some police shootings that have been questionable lately, right? And I'm the first to back the police officer every single
time.
When
they're right?
But no, every single time first.
See, I stopped doing that, man.
First I do it until I see it.
Okay. So you give them the benefit of the doubt.
Right. In other words, no. I don't give them the benefit of the doubt because I don't see the doubt.
Ah.
When I see the doubt,
it's the benefit of the Dowd.
That's funny, right? So, but from my perspective, I look at it and say, I went to work every day, and I just told you before, I pulled my gun out 8 to 15 times a day, and never one time fired around at a person.
Oh, really?
I squeezed my trigger 3 times, almost killed the police officer, one of them.
Oh, wow.
Undercover narcotics detective, but never once fired around at an individual. Because I had a little bit of restraint, and more so that I didn't go there looking to shoot anybody.
Right.
I've had people come up to me later on, perps, and say to me, why didn't you shoot that motherfucker?
Really?
Yeah, and I'm like, because I didn't have to.
Right.
And it wasn't like I was scared to fire off a round, let me tell you right now. You know,
sure.
If you do me
you
dirty.
You didn't need to do it, though. You didn't need to do it.
I didn't need to. And I look at the one with a guy who was accused of sexually assaulting his girlfriend. He was shot in the back in the
car. Oh, yeah,
the
car. Jacob Blake. That was the whole thing that started everything in Milwaukee,
I look at that,
Wisconsin.
Right? And that bothers me terribly. Now, I'm not there. I don't know every fact. But from what I saw, if he's getting in the car, let him get in the goddamn car.
Well, I'm sure those officers wish they had made that decision now. Just like the guy who shot the man in Denver wishes he hadn't done that.
Those are his kids. He's had custody of his kids.
Right. So it's not like he's kidnapping any. He's not.
Maybe it's a custody issue going on, you know?
Right.
And if he did come out with the knife, blow his
shoot him.
Blow
That's
his
shoot
fucking
him.
Brains out sure. then. That's not when not when you're thinking he's going to, you know. I mean, right. look, I don't know. I didn't see what he made.
I haven't even seen all the angles of the video
right.
on that.
Right.
And I've refrained. Anybody who's following me on social media, you'll see that I've largely refrained from even mentioning that situation because I don't have all the available
information. But I'm quantifying, qualifying it, the fact that I don't know exactly what he saw. But that bothered me because I know to de-escalate. Now, they did shoot him with a taser, but that because he got away doesn't mean he's the dead guy. That's, you know.
Right. Okay, he got away. Okay, the taser didn't work.
Yeah, it didn't work.
And again, and this is what I say in all these situations.
So if he climbed over a fence and went in someone's pool, do you shoot? No, you don't.
Right, you're not going to hit him with a taser then. Right.
No, you're not going to shoot him. You're not going to shoot him then because he beat the taser. Oh, well, you know. Well, clearly, it happens a lot more than we think, right?
Right.
A lot of people beat this taser for some reason, you know?
Yeah, more than taser, but I want you to know.
Yeah. I hope if I get one, I can beat it.
You luck out?
I can beat it, yeah.
Yeah. That's a hell of a ride.
Yeah, I don't know.
Believe me, it's a hell of a ride.
No, you do some tactical.
I was an instructor, so I had to get. So when I became a taser instructor.
Oh, they tasered you?
No, you had to get juice. When you become an instructor, you got to get hit with a taser.
Fuck that.
So that's what I said. So I'm standing up there, and they don't hit you with the darts unless you volunteer for that, which I didn't.
Right.
But they take tape, and they tape the leads. They take the darts, and they tape them to your body.
Okay.
They put one on my right shoulder and one on the top of my left foot, so the arc would go through my entire body from top to bottom, right? And right before they hit me with it, I said, let me tell you guys something, man. I'm a submachine gun instructor. I'm a shotgun instructor. I'm a pistol instructor. And I never had to stand up and get shot in order to get instructor rating for any of these things. So why do I got to get hit with this taser?
Until I know.
And so then they said, okay, well, state your name. They had a video. State your name.
Because died. Did you sign a
right, consent? I should have signed a waiver,
right? Consent?
So I finished that, and I start saying my name. I go, my name is Sergeant. And they hit me with that fucking thing. And all I could say was, God damn it. So for the rest of the class, my name was Sergeant Goddamn. Because that taser is no joke. Yeah. That talking about a ride, that Edison medicine ain't no joke, man.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So, you know, we got a situation where people, so Walter Scott was a turning point for me when he was murdered by Michael Slager in South Carolina. He was running away, traffic stop, expired tabs or something.
Okay.
He's got a child support warrant. He takes off running. Officer shoots him. As he's running away through a park, shoots him and goes over and throws his taser on him and says in the report, he took my taser, tried to use it, so I shot him, not knowing that somebody was videoing the whole thing. So that officer, righteously so, went to prison.
Right.
I didn't see anybody trying to justify what he did, thankfully. I didn't see any police officers standing up for him.
Yeah.
And cops who normally are very, very pro-police to the point of it being a fault of theirs.
Right.
Could not justify that, didn't even try. Thank God, good on them.
Right.
But when I first heard about it, I thought, there's no way that dude did that.
Yeah, I think I recall this.
Yeah, I'm like, bullshit, he didn't. There's no way he did that.
So there was trees around?
Yeah, there was trees around. Okay. Exactly.
Yeah, I remember.
Because the guy filming it was like between trees or something.
So
I'm thinking, you know, let me tell you something.
Like, that's a criminal.
There's no way.
That's a criminal, man.
That's what I'm saying. That guy murdered that dude.
Yeah.
And lied about it. And
well,
that
of course
happened.
He lied about it.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, I did it on purpose. Come
yeah, no, he made up a story. And
I lied about a few things in my life, too.
But there was zero reason to do this.
Yeah.
The guy was running away.
Yeah.
The guy didn't fight with you.
Yeah.
The guy didn't talk about your mama before he ran or anything.
Nothing.
He just ran.
Didn't spit at you.
And he got, and he got murdered. And at that point.
Didn't take his Chinese food.
None of that. Didn't do none of that. So I said, damn.
But the hot sauce, I'll forget about it.
I said, you know, I said, going forward, I better start looking at some of this stuff with a grain of salt. Because there are some people out there doing some shit they shouldn't be doing, right? There's officers out there doing stuff they shouldn't be doing. And so now, I'm going to tell you, I went too far to the other side.
But hold on. Wait a minute.
I don't automatically give the benefit
of
that anymore.
Like there's a pile of them.
Well, okay, here's the other one.
What?
Here's
there's
the other
42,000 New York City police officers. Okay.
Sure.
There's 15,000 LA and sheriffs and counties.
There's a whole, there are almost three quarters of a million police officers in this country.
And they probably interact with the people over a million times a day. At least.
Well over that.
Right.
And so the percentage is infinitesimal. And I will be the first to admit that. And I'm not saying that I've abandoned any defense of the police, right?
But
let me tell you something. When shit keeps happening and you say, well, damn, that shouldn't have happened either. And then that shouldn't have happened either.
Of course.
And so, because we hear about these anomalies.
Let's hear about the good shit then.
Well, I think that that's our default position. Everybody knows that, that's what we do.
That we do good stuff all day long?
People know
when
that.
When I say we, I mean...
The police. Yeah. Right? So that headline is like dog bites man. Nobody gives a shit about that headline.
Yeah, that's why I get
man bites dog
I get
is a
documentary.
Headline.
You don't.
Right, exactly. Nobody knows who I am. Most of you guys are tuning in for Mikey. You're not tuning in for me. Right? Because I don't have a documentary.
I apologize in
right?
Advance.
Yes. Hey, you know, I don't have a documentary.
I get it.
So I think that when I saw that was a big turning point.
But I don't have a pension. But I don't have a pension either.
Well, that's true.
All right. So there. So crime doesn't really pay.
Right, not in the long run.
Right.
Right? Now, it did for a minute, but not in the long run, right?
I had a good ride.
He had a good ride.
And a ride-along show.
Yeah, now you're here. Landed you here. So I don't want to beat the Denver thing to death because I know we're starting to run out of time. So you are now doing, you're a police ethics consultant?
Well, now? that's like word jargon, whatever you want to, I've done some work with NYPD, when I first came home, they asked me to do some, help them with their internal affairs.
Did you speak to the academy classes or something like that?
They wouldn't let me.
Oh,
really? I mean, but stop. They wouldn't let me.
Wow.
Yeah, they're fucked up. But because if I save one kid.
That's what I'm saying.
That's all it takes.
I would think that they would be, who else would
one.
You want? It's like Scared Straight to get you up
so,
there.
So they took the 7/5 documentary and it's issued, and every single person in the New York City Police Academy sees the 7/5 documentary.
Okay.
So my...
Well, that's better then.
No, it isn't.
Except they can't ask you questions.
It pisses me off. Because
they can't ask you questions.
I don't get paid anything for it, one. And two, not that I wouldn't do it for free for them.
Sure.
But it would legitimize my ability and value to other police departments
around
the country. And you know what?
I have a story
to share with people that can turn one person in your police department. Maybe one of these people might not have did a shooting, or maybe they wouldn't have gone down the wrong path. If they ran into a guy like me who they can identify with as a human being.
I tell you firsthand.
It's a human being that has a family, that loves him, that has two other brothers that are police officers and two brothers that are firemen and a father that was a fireman, that... You too can fuck up if you allow yourself to go down that path. And think about the cost to an organization.
Right, for that situation, one guy.
One guy can ruin the reputation of 15,000 police officers that do their job good every day. And I hold on to that because I don't want to see that happen because of what I did. And now, mind you, 250 police officers were arrested between the time I was arrested and the time I was sentenced.
This is NYPD only or just nationwide?
NYPD.
What?
Yeah.
Shit.
Yeah. So it's not like I was the cutout, but I became the cutout. I mean, that's okay. I'll take that burden, like New York's dirtiest cop ever, whatever they want to say.
Right.
But the fact is that I feel... You know, I want to justify the things that I've been through and the cross that I had to bear. I mean, look... I get cops calling me up for help and other cops saying, you were never a cop, you're a low-life scumbag.
Yeah.
And it's something that, I'm just telling you, it happens. You know?
I know, I believe you, but I think it's chicken shit because it's still, you still did things in the street that made a difference.
Well, I did
before.
My time. But I did my time.
And you did your time
also
in prison.
And you know what? And this is one of the things that pisses me off about cops. And remember what I'm saying to you cops out there. The guy that's next to you that gets jammed up, who saved your life yesterday, he's still the same guy.
Right.
Okay. They turn their back on each other because that puts a bad reflection upon them. If the guy was your friend and at dinner the night before, if he gets jammed up, you turn your back on him?
Well, yeah, but see, and that's another thing. And I don't want to get too deep into that point, but cops are conformist. And that is a lot of the part of the problem that I see with law enforcement.
Okay.
Is that we prize conformity above doing the right thing sometimes.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
This is why we select people. We check your background to make sure you've conformed and you've crossed all the T's and dotted all the I's in your life.
Yeah.
We talk to your high school teachers, and we talk to everybody you live with and everything, because we want to make sure that you are a conformist, right? The problem with conformists is that they conform, and they get in an organization, and they can see something ain't right, and nobody else is saying something, they ain't going to say nothing.
Right.
Because they don't want to be the
odd
man.
What did I say
out
when they introduced me on this film? I said, I wasn't afraid of being turned in. The cops around me would never turn me in.
Right.
You know, and those that worked closely with me didn't. There was a couple of rats along the way. But no one wanted to hear them.
But you also had to know who you could do stuff in front
of
and who you couldn't.
Absolutely.
That's why
100%.
And that's why I worry sometimes that there was a lot of shit that went on that I never saw, because people knew I wasn't with the shits. So you couldn't do certain things.
But that's okay.
Around me.
But that was
because
okay
that wasn't
with
my
me.
Program.
But that was okay with me. But you saw, you know.
Right.
You know.
You get an idea.
You know.
Sure.
You know. But I work with people like yourself, and I respected them and didn't do that to them.
Right, because you put that person in a bad position.
I would never do that if that guy was not willing.
Sure.
So, well, I'm not a fucking hero for it, but I guess my point is, if you towed the line, and if you were working with someone like me, if I couldn't get you to cross the line, I wouldn't leave by myself, because now I'm subject to you.
Right.
Getting me in trouble, having me arrested.
Sure.
And because everything we do as a police officer that's not right is wrong.
Hmm. That's a good point. Yeah. Now let me ask you this: do you ever miss being on the job?
So one of the things that we glossed on the way over here before on the studio was when I came out of prison after doing 12 and a half years, I wanted to go back to prison.
Really?
I didn't like. I couldn't.
You've been institutionalized in that period?
It was too fast. 12 and a half years is a long fucking time.
Yeah, it is. That's longer than you were a cop, right?
Yeah, I was a cop for 10 years. So. So I became institutionalized in many ways. My mind really didn't, but I physically became used to the society of prison. Mm-hmm. So it was just easy, right? And then at some point, I just felt like I couldn't look at police officers. And because I felt like I was embarrassed of what I did, which of course I was, And then I they had these new uniforms, by the way, which I hated. They looked like garage mechanics.
Well, that was the blue,
the dark blue fucking thing.
What we wear out here.
They look like garage mechanics. I hate that. They had these pockets on the sides. They looked like garage mechanics. I like the powder blue. I know it was a little in the store, but it was distinguishing. You know, anyway, looking at the cop, I want to go over and say hello. How you doing, officer? But I lost that family.
Yeah, you don't know how you're going to be received.
I lost that family. I lost 750,000 family members.
Sure.
And that's really, I hate, that's the worst thing of this. Never mind, sure. I lost my pension. And then, of course, the ones that said you were never a cop. And, of course, you defend me in that area. And I appreciate that. But the reality is they earned the right, they feel, to say that to me, even though they don't. Because I did do my job as a police officer. I robbed people, but whatever. But the point is, they were drug dealers. You know what I mean? It's like the mafia guys, they kill each other. No one gets mad at them. That's what they do. You know, you're a drug dealer. I gave you a free pass. It was quid pro quo, Joe. I mean, you know, it was
occupational hazard.
It was quid pro quo. I didn't do it for free. You know, like, I didn't go to your house, knock on your door, and rob you. I could have, but I didn't. I didn't. You know, that's not who I am.
Right.
My point is, you know, You were playing the game, it just happened.
Well, if you're in the life, I mean, everybody understands the occupational hazard.
Exactly. It was the wrong thing to do. I'm not proud of it, but what it is I owned it. And I still own it because that's why I'm on the show with you. Because I own what I did.
Sure.
And I testified against myself. At the Mullen Committee.
Yes, I did see that.
Okay.
Now, let me tell you somebody
and that's the first day I became a new person.
That was the first step. When you and I first got in contact a few years ago, you put me in touch with a guy who was a producer or a writer or something.
Right.
And what he said to me was, because I didn't really know you yet, I just knew what I'd seen on TV and, on the documentary, and then you had done the Combat Jack appearance.
Right, right. And,
and so I said, and a guy asked me, he goes, so let me ask you a question. He goes, before we go any further with this conversation, he says, are you pro Mike Dowd or are you con Mike Dowd? I go, I had to pause because I didn't really know you yet.
Right.
And I had to pause and I said to him, I am pro the redemption of Mike Dowd.
There you go. Thank you.
You know what I mean?
Right.
And that's the conversation I had with the dude, because you went in, you did your time, and I saw that you were out trying to assist former agency
right.
with avoiding some of the stuff in the future, right? And I saw that you were on the path to redemption. And on one of those shows, I think it might have been Joe Rogan that you were on. And somebody called in, and the guy really gave you a bunch of shit. The guy was really, he was really murder mouthing
you. Right.
And you stopped and you said, hey, I'm sorry, brother. I am. And it looked very genuine to me. And I said, so this isn't a dude who's out here, like, you know, like whatever about
right,
it.
Right.
This dude understands that he did some stuff he shouldn't have done, quite a few things he shouldn't have done.
Right.
Went and did his time for those things. And now he's out, and the man's got to eat, and the man's got a unique perspective. He's got a unique story. He's got something to contribute.
Yeah, and we haven't gotten into my time in prison and what it was like to be a cop. Of course, it was a lot of fun, you know.
Well, yeah, but
being
you know
a cop
what?
In prison was fun.
We'll get into that on a future show, for sure. yeah, absolutely.
It's a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah. You listen, man, let me tell you something about the fun of being a police officer. I had so much fun, especially my first year as a police officer. I came out in the summer of 89.
Right.
Friend of mine had borrowed some money from me, civilian, He worked at a really nice, a high-end shoe store, a children's clothing store in Beverly Hills. So he said, hey, man, come by before you go to work. I got the money I borrowed from you. So I go to his job, and he pays me the money, and I'm standing there looking at all this environment. He's in beautiful women with money, and the guy's in air condition, and he's, you know, he's like, I really like it here, and da-da-da. So I'm like, he's got a cool job. So I go to work. I'm a trainee, so I'm out in the car waiting for my training officer to come out. I got the car all squared away. I'm sitting in the police car, and I'm thinking, I go, Clarence has got a cool job, man. He's really enjoying it, and it's a nice, cool environment. And, I guess I got to get a job at some point. I'm in full uniform sitting in a police car.
I got to get a job.
Thinking I got to get a job. That's how much I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
That's right. How fun this job is.
Yeah, no.
When you're doing it right and when you got there, you still hear the jazz, you know?
Yeah, it was fun. I loved every day.
Yeah.
Every day. I mean, we had our gripes against departments, right? I mean,
that's the problem. You know, my stress came from inside the station wall. It didn't come from out the
street. Right, not the street. I love the street. Right. And the street loved me in a lot of ways, believe me. I'm going to tell you. No, they did. I mean, Officer Mike, you know, I mean, and some of the victims of crime, I got to know them and their families.
Sure.
You know, which you don't often get. You don't often get that follow through.
Right.
You know, because I was in the same location for, like, I went to, they shipped me out to Coney Island because I was getting jammed up. And so they shipped me to Coney Island to cool off.
Uh-huh.
I come back, and like 5-6 months later, one of the kids in the neighborhood, like a young kid, like 6-7-year-old kid.
Yeah.
His mother was raped, whatever. His sister was raped. I forget. Young kid, like 10-11-year-old kid was raped. But I got to know the family by handling the case.
Sure.
And uncle raped him. And and the kid goes, Officer Mike, you're back.
He's glad to see you.
I mean, he's an 8-year-old kid.
He's glad to see you,
And I was going to the bodega to get my beer and my
sure, your stuff, right?
My stuff, my hookup for the day, whatever it was, you know.
Right.
And but like to see the kid say that, but like it brought a tear to my eye. Like, this kid fucking liked me.
He made
man.
A difference in his
yeah,
life, man.
Yeah, and that was so cool. And I was probably 24, 25, like
oh,
that.
Oh wow.
Yeah, yeah. And it was very to me. It was like a great feeling.
Yeah, bad. Sure.
There's many other great things that I felt.
Oh, yeah, but that's just one example
just
of a 10-year
like,
career,
like,
sure.
Yeah, like how often does that happen? I mean,
doesn't happen
I don't
often.
Know. You were a cop 15 years, 20 years almost now, right?
Doesn't happen too often.
Yeah.
Doesn't happen often enough.
Yeah,
how about that?
Yeah, it was great to see, you know. And then the bodega owners were mad at me because I was gone.
Right, where'd
like,
you go?
Where you been?
Right.
Like, dude, I cost you about $50 a week with the...
right, with the cigarettes and the beer.
Between the cigarettes.
Right. Oh, we have... Okay, cool. We'll take the call then. So, caller, what's your name? Where are you calling from?
Yeah, Chuck Graves, calling from Los Angeles.
Hey, Chuck. How's it going? Lay it on
pretty
us.
Pretty good. Hey, George. I have a quick question for Mr. Dowd.
Yeah.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So, I mean, there's a lot of information out there, Mike, about what your involvement was when you were with the NYPD.
Right.
And I have to say, you know, the redeeming... quality in all of this was the fact that you weren't a snitch and you didn't rat on anybody. You took your lumps and did your time.
But I
just want to ask you if you, you know, looking back, if you felt that, you know, how were you treated during the internal affairs process?
Okay, so the process of when I came
thanks,
out.
Thanks, Chuck.
Well,
thanks
what, so is he still on?
Are you still on?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, so okay. The process when I came out or during my arrest process.
Well, both. I think there. I think that
you're gonna.
There's gonna be two sides to that story, right?
Right.
And there's gonna be two times when they were involved, both
Right. So when I was arrested, like, let's say, if you talk about when I was arrested, because there was other instances with internal affairs also, which I, and this show is too late to get into. But the reality is the arrest process, they were pretty shitty to me. Okay. But you know what? You can't blame them. They were mad. You know, okay. And in the end, before I got sentenced, one officer came to me, Mike Gagliotti, sergeant. He said to me, just before I was getting ready to be sentenced, he said to me, "You're going to do some time, but you got a life in front of you. He said, you know, and I wish you the best."
Wow.
Yeah. So, and he was kind in that way. I mean, I wanted to kill him. Right. Not at the time, but right. At my house right. When he arrested me. So then afterward, when I came out, you know, look. I'm filled with hope, right? I'm a hope guy. I have hope. I have aspirations and dreams.
Okay.
And when I came out, my hope was to be able to give back the NYPD, but then to get a full-blown career of going around from department to department.
Sure.
Based on their sanctioning by, because I helped produce a video for them.
Oh, okay.
Besides the documentary, they had an internal video of me and whatnot. But they really, you know, I think Ray Kelly was back in charge at the time.
Oh, okay.
And he was not favorably.
He wasn't feeling you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to do anything that's going to help Dowd. Is basically what he said. So, sure. So he, you know, he sort of left me dragging my feet, but that's okay. He didn't owe me anything. You know, I just wish that it worked out differently because I think I had a lot to give back to police departments, and clearly they show my video in every.
So
in
clearly
every
you
academy.
Did. Yeah.
So, but thanks for the question, pal.
Hey, thanks.
Stay safe.
Thanks for the question.
Yeah, I think it's right up there with Perfect, though, man, in terms of most viewed documentaries.
There's no question. It's one of the most ever. Yeah, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. And, hey, thanks a lot for putting those cigars out, too, man. We really enjoy it.
You got it, brother.
All right. Good stuff. I keep telling everybody.
Right,
75
buddy.
Cigars. Thanks good stuff.
Lot. Yeah.
Thanks, Chuck.
All right. God bless. Thanks.
All right. So that was our final caller, and that's going to take us to the end of our show, of this episode of the Ride Along Radio Show. So I would implore you all to follow us on our social media platforms.
The Mike Dowd on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. It's Michael Dowd, I believe. But I'm out there. You'll find me.
And Ride Along Radio Show is our Twitter is at Ride Along Radio. Instagram is at Ride Along Radio Show. And if you want to email us any kind of questions, comments, concerns, or ideas for show topics, you can email us at ridealongradioshow@gmail.com. So until the next episode, I'm George Holt.
Mike Dowd.
And this has been Ride Along Radio Show. Thanks for rolling with us.
Whoop, whoop. That's the sound of the police.
Whoop, whoop.
That's the sound of the beast.
Whoop, whoop.
That's the sound of the police.
Whoop, whoop.
That's the sound of the beast.